Hello and welcome to everybody who've joined in. I'm Natasha from Sapna Book House, and today you're at episode 2 of Sapna Rise, and we have an amazing author with us today. We have Rupa Pai. I'm just going to add her quickly.
Hi.
Hello.
How are you?
Fine, thank you.
Let me introduce Rupa Pai to all our viewers. So she's a computer engineer who turned into a journalist and then an author. She has penned more than 20 books and she has been a children's bestseller author. And she's done some phenomenal work in the field of journalism too. So welcome to Sapna Rise, ma'am. We welcome you on behalf of Sapna Book House.
Thank you, Natasha. This is such a pleasure to be here talking to you and to Sapna, at an event hosted by Sapna.
How are you? How is the whole summer been?
Unusual, to put it mildly.
Okay.
It's been very different from a usual summer.
Okay.
And I think I'm very lucky. Sunny today, such a beautiful day outside. I can see the clouds and the blue sky. I feel very, very lucky that I'm a resident of Bangalore, where the summer is never too bad and the monsoon comes early. And, you know, I know that people in other parts of India are really suffering with the heat and the humidity, but we are very lucky.
We've been blessed with good weather, in fact.
I'm just counting my blessings, actually, every day. I mean, talk about gratitude, but right now, just so grateful for every little thing. Stop taking things for granted.
So tell us about your latest work. What have you been doing through the couple of months?
4 months. Actually, so this year I had decided to take a sabbatical.
Okay.
Well before. Because my first set of books, Taranauts, which is a fantasy adventure series for children and actually India's first such fantasy adventure series.
Okay.
For children. It came out in 2009. So
okay.
And since then, continuously producing book after book and have a wonderful 10 years, 11 years. So I thought to myself, you know, maybe it's time to just slow down this year and not write anything, but spend time in reflection and reading.
Okay.
A lateral field that might inform my field of writing, that will rejuvenate my creativity and things like that, and spend some time just being with myself rather than always rushing to be meeting some other deadline. Mm-hmm. Although I love life, but I thought it might be to just calm down. And then it just turned out that the whole world decided to take a sabbatical along with me.
Yeah.
Sort of my sabbatical. So
this
I was very
Yeah, please go on.
No, so that's happening. But I've been quite happily employed even through the lockdown and the thing.
That's amazing.
Doing things. Yeah, I mean, the thing is, as I was telling you in our conversation yesterday, this is my life, actually. Being at home the whole day is actually... As a writer, I do spend a lot of time by myself and at home in front of my computer, my desk, working.
Okay.
And the concept of working from home is what I am, what I do anyway. Work home in pajamas is already what I do anyway. So
that's a dream job. It seems like a dream, and I think this whole period has been so amazing for like self-introspection or just time for yourself, or even as a matter of fact to work on things that you always wanted to do, some hobbies which you've never gotten the time to do. So it's kind of been fruitful, both pros and cons, actually.
No, I think it's a very good thing. It's a recommended thing to press the pause button on your life for a little while from time to time and withdraw and look inward rather than outside all the time. When it's forced upon us like this, in the beginning we resent it a little bit, but I think once we sort of get into it, we realize there are a lot of wonderful benefits to be had from this. And in fact, driving around Bangalore in the last few weeks and enjoying the lengths of the commute, which have fallen dramatically, I'm like, do I want it to go back to what it was before? Will I be able to deal with that? And it just tells you adaptability of humans, how quickly we can change our mindsets to fit
That's
into
true.
New situations. So that gives me hope for humanity in general. You know, we are able to adapt to anything, and we will. The human spirit will triumph. Human innovation will triumph. Human creativity will triumph over all odds. So I'm very
hopefully,
hopeful.
Ma'am. Hopefully, and hopefully this comes and settles down very soon.
Yeah, I hope. I wish this didn't have to be the reason why we are all pausing. But
yeah,
sometimes need something like this. Yeah.
True. Tell us about your journey. How did computer engineer to journalist to like a best-selling children's author happen? I mean, it seems like a drastic graph to me.
Yeah, well, so for me, I mean, anybody from Bangalore like me will identify with this, that basically everybody had to become an engineer when I
That's
was growing
true.
Up. It was what, you know, if you were not smart enough to be a doctor, like this doctor, medical seats were very few. And
Correct.
You had to really work hard and basically give up your life in 11th and 12th and the rest of your medicine career.
Yeah.
Perhaps even like some basically medicine, medical career, doctor career as a doctor involved, sacrifice. So if you were not into that, then you either, I mean, what else was there? There was engineering and perhaps law, but even that has become, you know, coveted now of late, maybe in the last 15 years. Before that, when I was growing up, it was just engineering. Otherwise, you will end up on the dung heap. At least every Indian middle-class family thought this way.
Yes,
so when you happened to get into engineering, you did engineering. And my mom was very like, you know, no child of mine, no daughter of mine will ever have to depend on any man for any, you know, financial help and stuff. So everyone should be professionally qualified. All my girls. I mean, the two of us, sisters and a brother. So she's a doctor, I'm an engineer, my brother's a lawyer, perfect middle class
so
family dream. So I did, and I was the kind of child who would not rebel so much and say, no, I will not. Because actually what I wanted to do was perhaps do literature,
okay.
Study literature.
Okay.
Yeah, because I always wanted to write. So actually for me, writing is not a deviation from what I am. Engineering was. I just took that little detour and then came back to
came
what
back.
I always wanted.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I think somewhere when I was 13 or something, when I came across a fabulous Indian children's magazine called Target, my dreams, just wanting to be a writer, changed, got a little more crystallized, a little more focused. I said, I want to be a children's.
Okay.
Because
wow.
Magazine has beautiful stories. I just wanted to work for them.
Okay.
I just wanted to join the magazine. That became my dream job. And I said, I want to write Indian stories for Indian children. And I want Indian children to feel a sense of pride in their culture, in who they are. And not even more than a sense of pride, even just to understand where they come from, what they are about, and not be so drawn in by stories from only from the cultures and have a feeling that somehow stories are better than ours or more exciting than ours. I wanted to somehow bring that wonder of Indian story to Indian children. So I think that's how this whole journey happened.
And I must say, you've done such a fantastic job in doing that, because I've personally read your books. I mean, 99 Reasons and Ways to Become a World Conquering Teenager. It's such an amazing book. I mean, the whole process of how you've actually penned down ways to make chai. You've taught kids how to wear dhotis and saris. You've taught them about biology, literature, history. I mean, there's everything. It's literally a Bible for a teenager. And especially in an Indian scenario, because this is not something that we learn every day. Nobody teaches us how to make chai, but we're expected to learn how to make chai at one point. So I think this is a must read for everybody. How did this happen? How did this idea come to you?
That's a good question. That's an interesting story, actually. So I had just finished writing the Gita for Children,
okay.
I think. And I wanted, and you know, it did very well, and it was very much loved and taken to, everybody took it to their hearts. And so immediately a lot of people, including my editor, and my editor is the one who actually made me write the Gita for Children. I would never have done it if my editor at Hachette, that call, hadn't pushed me in that direction. And I was very reluctant, but I did it. And even then, when it came out, I was like keeping my fingers crossed that no one will take it throw stones at my house because it's a very revered, living, breathing text. You cannot afford to take liberties with it. But somehow it was very well accepted. So then she said, you know, maybe you should do now the Vedas and Upanishads or some other in the same genre. And I was like, no, excuse me, I don't want to be bracketed as that kind of writer. I am interested in many things and I don't want to be like a spiritual writer. My name is not Rupa Ma, you know, like that kind of stuff. So I need to write different things. So I wrote a book on economics for children called So You Want to Know About Economics. And I said, what else can I do that's different? And I wrote a book on Krishnadevaraya of Hampi, of Vijayanagara, which is, he's one of my favorite things in Hampi, my absolute favorite place in the world.
Wow.
And then I was thinking what else to do, I was running out of ideas, but I mean, just thinking. And my editor, same editor, came up with this idea that, hey, do you know about the Scouts and Guides movement? And I'm like, yes, I loved it. I was a guide. I was a girl guide growing up, you know, and I just feel so bad that they don't offer it so much that as a activity in schools much anymore. It used to be big when I was growing up, Scouts and Guides, but it doesn't happen anymore. So then she said, you know, do you think we need an upgraded Indian version of that, like life skills? Because really what Scouts and Guides movements was about was providing life skills to youngsters.
Yeah.
How to survive. And it was very much focused on the wild, actually. You know, how to find your way in a place that you don't know. And it was originally, the way it was written 110 years ago was about war.
Okay.
You know, it started, it was put together by, the movement came together because of Lord Baden-Powell, who was an army officer, British officer, who found that children, young people were very useful when he was defending a fort in Africa. He found that they were very useful to him because the adults were always occupied defending the fort and he could use the skills of teenagers. And he said, why should it be that in wartime we use teenagers? Why don't I create something? Even in peacetime, I want to create a whole breed, a whole generation of self-reliant, cheerful, resourceful young people who are always ready to do things for their country and for their community and for themselves. He did the Scouts. And I had been a guide myself. And I said, you know, that is such a perfect idea. We really need something like that because self-reliance, the dependence on others in India particularly is so high, dependence on domestic. Everybody thinks that somebody else should be picking up after them, that they are not responsible for this. Even for the litter in front of their own house, as long as it's on the road, we are not responsible for it, you know. So anything you want to call up somebody to come help you. And so I said, yeah, I think that's a great idea we should do. So that's how, you know, the Scouts, it's totally inspired by the Scouts and Guides movement. And the Scouts and Guides motto is be prepared, right?
Okay.
So that's why this book is called Ready. But it is an upgraded Bible for teenagers and almost teenagers with life skills, and it's for urban Indian teenagers particularly.
Okay. Wow. I mean, that is so thoughtful. Because as you said, even I have read a couple of your books. You've written about economics. You've written about sports. You're a sports enthusiast. So you've actually penned down Milind Soman's book Made in India too. So you've written about so many genres and you've written about so many things. I can proudly say that you're a very diverse author. You've covered everything that is needed, you know. So that's amazing. How did Milind Soman's book happen?
That's a very nice story. I love counting that story because it was so unexpected how it happened. And the reason why I write books on so many different topics is that I think I'm a curious person and attention span is a little limited. So once I've written in a particular genre, I feel like I want to write about something else, like, you know, and I find this writing for children books is an opportunity to get into a field or a subject that nothing about, understand it really well, and then write it in a simplified form for children. Because when you have to write something complex and reduce it to something that children can understand, that increases your own understanding of the subject very deeply.
Yeah.
Your clarity improves. So anyway, so Milind Soman's book is for adults. It's not for children. It's my only book so far for adults. And how that happened was when the Rio Olympics were going on. I'm a sports enthusiast, and I'm particularly into Indian women athletes, female athletes.
Amazing. So,
love following their stories, and you know, I find it like absolutely fascinating, and I feel they just don't get as much exposure and recognition as they need. Now it's changed, of course, but it didn't always. I think now people are very, very conscious and aware, because Indians are a sports mad nation anyway. Whether True. We are good at sport or not, whether we win the medals or not, we've always been huge followers of sport. Yeah. Of sport. So during the Rio Olympics, I came across this lovely story. I just posted something about the badminton team, the women's okay. badminton team, and then across the story of this Dattu Bokanal, who's a Indian rower.
Okay.
He just Olympics, and I happened to read a story about him, which talked about his really, really poor origins. That he comes from a very backward part of Maharashtra, a very poor family of and community of well diggers.
Okay.
And how he was terrified of the water, so he could not be in the family profession because well digging. So one of the options open to him was to join the army, and so he joined the army. Army is like a huge draw for people from poorer communities also, because you know they get taken care of. So he was all strapping young man, joined the army, and then when he was assessed by the sporting department in the army, they thought his physique was perfect for rowing, and this man is afraid of water, terrified of water. But he also knew that if he started to try to be do well at sport in the army, promotions would come, and you know, there would be other opportunities. So he put his fears aside and he began to row. And I think in a year or two after he had begun to row, he got into the Olympics. I mean, he qualified to be in an Olympic team from India. And that's anyone who even qualifies for the Olympics is a freak. Okay. I mean, they are way, way ahead of other people in the world because of. So anyway, he went to the. So I just wrote about him that, can you imagine? And then his mom had fallen down or something, hit her head, and she was completely in a coma when he was in Rio.
Oh my God.
And I said, how is it that his mother will not know what her son has achieved right now, where he is, will not participate in this wonderful journey of her son? And I said, it takes all kinds of courage to be an Olympian. So I was just celebrating that. Okay, so I just put that story on my Facebook post, and I went away to do my usual stuff. And then sometime a few hours later, I logged in and I saw it had something like 700 likes. I mean, 700. And that had never happened to me, Facebook story of mine before. And then I shares, and again, that was also huge. I was like, oh my God, this is going, what they call going viral. Oh my God, my story is going viral. Okay, I felt very excited. And then I thought it was a freak thing, and checked again some few hours later, it was just going up. And that was, you know, then suddenly I felt a responsibility that people were so proudly sharing it, feeling so happy to share this. Then I felt like, oh, I should just do this every day, you know, of the Olympics, whatever days are left, I should highlight one particular Indian athlete who is taking part that day and write about her, mostly it was her, write about her story and the journey there. Because the what we see in the Olympics on the race day is only the very tip of the iceberg, the culmination of years and years and years of hard work and sacrifice.
Right.
Lots of years and a lot of mental resilience to get back up, go back on. So I thought I should put about that. And that went on becoming viral. Every post was viral. People were waiting for the next post to come up. So every day this happened. Okay, so this began to happen. It was a new experience, but I felt such a huge responsibility that I needed to do this for the Indian athletes. And then one day when this was going on, I got lots of friend requests began to come. People wanted to follow my page, etc. And then suddenly there was a comment from a Milind Soman.
Oh, wow.
Somebody who called him Milind Soman, saying how well you write. And then I got a friend request also. And I was like, one sec, is this the hunk, the supermodel of my youth that we all grew up adoring and thinking like, oh my God, what a good looking guy and what a fabulous model. Could it be the same person? So I did my little background check. I stalked him on Facebook. I realized it was the same guy. And of course I said, thank you, Milind. Very kind. Accepted his friend request. And I thought that would be the end of that. I told everybody in my girlfriend universe, guess who wants to be my Facebook
My friend.
friend, guys. Yeah. So all that happened. And then, but then that, I thought that was the end of that. But a year later, an editor from Penguin called and she said, this was the Penguin adult book division, not the children's
okay.
book division. She said, you don't know me, etc. But you surely, you might have heard of somebody called Melinson. I'm like, yes, of course I have. And she says, you know, so we've been trying for a long time to get him to write his memoirs for us. And he's finally agreed. It looks like he's been brought to the table. He agrees, but he has a condition. And I said, okay. And I'm still wondering why they're telling me this.
Okay.
He wants you to write his book. I said, what?
Oh, wow.
Me? He said, yeah, he told us that there is this lady on Facebook and she writes very well about sport. I don't. And they said, and the Penguin people said, but is she a writer? You know, people write on Facebook.
Yeah. Course,
anyone can write many. But to construct a whole book, we have so many people, authors lined up for you. Don't you want to look at them and mm-hmm. choose from them? And he said, no, I will only do this if she will agree to write for it. I mean, at least if she says no, then we'll see. But I don't know if she's a writer, but she can write. So I think you should just ask her. And when they checked them, they found it was me. And they said, oh, you've written something. So you are a writer. So they were very relieved. And they said, would you mind writing this? And I'm like, you know, I don't usually write for adults. But if somebody like Millenium has asked for me, by me, of course, I'll do it. So that's how that book came along.
Yeah. Wow.
And it was a fabulous. Yeah.
Such an inspiring book, in fact, because there's so many things that he's written. And such hardships that he's gone through. And the best part about the book is he actually isn't trying to be an athlete. He just goes
yeah.
on a whim and just does something that interests him. So I think that is the takeaway that I personally loved about the book, that he doesn't have any goals. He doesn't have anything in mind. He's not doing it for others. He's just doing it because he finds it very curious.
He calls himself an explorer who follows the
yeah,
scent.
Yeah.
Anything that comes to him, if it's sort of something that's interesting, that he thinks is interesting, he will put his whole mind and soul into it
yeah.
without knowing the lead. But while he's chasing it, he will put his whole mind and soul into it and then whatever comes. So he's the kind of person who, you know, what the Gita says, the whole karmanyevadhikaraste, mahafaleshu kadachana, just focus on the effort. The fruits will come or will not come. That's not for you to worry about. That's for the universe to worry about. Whatever you are doing, you put your 100% effort. I mean, he's actually someone who has lived that, I found, and it has worked out so beautifully for him. So that's why he remains relaxed, no hang-ups kind of celebrity. It's very nice to meet him because in his mind, he's like a yogi.
That's nice. About your other book, Leeches to Slug Glue, now we've spoken about sports, we've spoken about Indian mythology. You've actually written about science. So Leeches to Slug Glue is about modern science, Ayurveda, about traditional methods of medicine across the world. How much effort did that take in? Because, you know, if you're writing a book about something, if you're writing a fictional story, you just have to make up characters. It's not easy, but it's still relatively more comfortable because it's a fragment of your imagination. But writing about something very technical, you need to be sure of what you're doing. You need to be sure of what you're writing because there are people reading it. And there's a lot of fact verification that happens. So how was the whole process of writing Leeches to Slug Glue?
Oh, fantastic. Because I think research is my superpower. I mean, I really okay. like doing research. And here's where I give thanks to my mom
okay.
and my parents for pushing me into science. Because I really owe it, I feel, to my science background that I do not get intimidated by science. Even
okay.
though I did engineering, not biology, and from Leeches to Slug Glue is about medicine, about the history of medicine mm-hmm. and deals more with biology. But sort of, you're not scared of a lot of data and a lot
yeah.
of terms you're familiar with. So and that it helped in that sense. But
okay.
the reason, I mean, even I was very surprised when she asked me to pick a topic to write about and I said, you know, I think I'll write about medicine. And she's like, why? For children, what is interesting about medicine? Why would you? I mean, it was such an off the beaten track topic that she couldn't understand why I would want to write this. And for me, I've always been fascinated by medicine, particularly
okay.
because my sister is a doctor, so
okay.
She's older than me. When she went into medicine, she was at home. She lived at home.
Okay.
Luckily, she went to medical
Okay.
in Bangalore.
Okay.
So I was a huge reader. I used to follow, and she used to come back with these fascinating stories every day. And she would talk with such excitement about dissection of cancers. And I'd be like, really? What? And my mom would be like, please, can we not have this conversation at the dining table? But, you know, her excitement was so palpable, totally infected me with it. And I used to read her textbooks, and they were all, you know, I mean, not obviously the fat books. The fat books were really fat, Grey's Anatomy, you know, but they were beautifully produced. And the color plates which showed the inside anatomy, muscles, these are always fascinating. I felt that, you know, when she passed out of her medicine, doctors were being treated like gods and goddesses at that time.
Back then, yeah.
Back then. But in the last few years, doctors have become like these villains of the piece, thought of as nothing but crooks who are always trying to make money, send you for tests you don't need. They get a cut from the lab and they don't spend time with you. They're not humane anymore. All they look at is the bottom line. So this kind of legend has spread about doctors, perhaps with some good reason. But the doctors that I see, I have 15 in my immediate family, 15 doctors. And doctors that I see are constantly working so hard to help people get better. And I'm like, this is not fair, you know, that they are treated like this. And I felt like Western medicine was getting a totally bad name, that Western medicine is only toxins. You're just putting poison in your body. You've got to stop doing that. I said, okay. And hospitals are terrible places. When you go in, you may never come out. And if you come out, you'll come out bankrupt. So there was no trust. Trust had completely broken down in the medical fraternity and the institutions of medicine and in the Western medicine itself. And I felt that, you know, children needed to be told that if you were born just 160, 170 years ago, your life would have been very, very different than it is now. For one thing, anesthesia hadn't been invented. So if you had to go into a surgery 170 years ago, not 500 years, just 160, 170 years ago, there was no anesthesia. So you would have to go into surgery and have it without the benefit of anesthesia.
Oh my God.
Until 140, 145 years ago, nobody had connected germs to disease. Nobody even knew germs caused disease. Just 140 years ago. And what progress we have since then. Today, we are living longer, more disease-free, more pain-free lives. We have eradicated things like smallpox and the plague can be contained. We know how to control epidemics. You know, so we should think about that and not throw out the baby with the bathwater. Sure, some of the bathwater has got dirty now. Big pharma and all that. There are a lot of things going wrong in the world of medicine. But how can we reject and forget the sacrifices and the dedication and the hard work of so many curious and dedicated men and women who have brought us to this stage of health?
True.
So I feel that children need to be reminded of this. The parents need to be reminded of this. And doctors need to be put back on the pedestal again. And I wrote it and it came out in September 2019. And who knew
that this
that 4 months later, this pandemic would hit. And once again, doctors and healthcare workers would be elevated to the pedestal they deserve. And again, we are dependent on Western medicine, vaccine trials, plasma therapy. All this is in my book. The first instances of plasma therapy, first instance of vaccine, how it was invented. And it's become such a relevant book suddenly.
True, you know? Very true. I think... Sorry?
That's how the medicine book happened. I said, you know, that's how it came.
But it's such an inspiration, you know, because for us living in the comforts of our home, we're safe here. For them to be out there for so many hours, I think 9 hours or 16 hours, they have shifts, and especially without taking a break. So it's a big thing.
And exposure to the germs that they are trying to help others recover from. They are constantly exposed to it.
True.
It's quite an amazing service they are doing, so we should think about and acknowledge them.
Definitely, ma'am. I think another of your latest work has been translating Kannada poems of late Dr. Nisar Ahmad, and you've actually translated about 100 poems. So how was that?
So this is again, I did in school, I did first language Kannada in the SSLC board. And first language not mean that the medium of instruction was Kannada, the medium of instruction was English. But Kannada, the Kannada paper had 150 marks as against 100 marks. So we did a very high level of in school. And I had a brilliant Kannada teacher. Her name was Bhagyalakshmi, and she really brought her love of Kannada literature to her class. And all of us were, blown away by it and began to love Kannada literature deeply. But, thinking, I thought in English always. I mean, I'm a Kannadiga, like risen from the soil, red soil of Karnataka. But I always thought in English, so I didn't actually work to do anything for Kannada. And I went off and did all this writing. But it has been bugging me for the last 4 or 5 years that, maybe I should give something back to Kannada, to Kannada literature. And one of the ways I thought was apt and which would help is to make the works of Kannada literators well known beyond the borders of Kannada, beyond the limits of the Kannada reading public. And so the Dr. Nisar Ahmed, I mean, I love many Kannada poets, but maybe three, and I'm born on November 1st. Okay, so my birthday is Kannada, so I know. So again, I felt a double responsibility of that. So a few years ago on Kannada Rajyotsava Day, I thought that whole week I will just try. I don't know how good I am, but I felt confident to be able to translate from Kannada to English, not from English to Kannada so much, but Kannada to English, sure. So every day I highlighted one poet and put it on my Facebook. I wrote a little bit about the Kannada poet. I translated one of his or her poems and put it up. And again, it got a lot of circulation, and people appreciated it very deeply. And I thought to myself, this needs to go a little further. And then somebody, one of my friends in Arunava Sinha, he saw it. He works in translation a lot from Bengali to English. And he said, would you share some of your poems for a journal, etc. So I began to do more of it. And one of the poems I had translated was of Professor Nisar Ahmed. And he said, will you give me five poems of any particular Kannada poet? I don't mind who. And I thought it'd be nice to give one of a living poet. All the other poets I had translated were dead. So I said, oh, this would. So I then went deeper into Nisar Ahmed's poetry. What I found just amazed me. I mean, the breadth of his concerns, the depth of his love for this land, and but he's also a science background. He's a geologist. So he brought all that. He was interested in so many different things, current events, politics, and then the simplest things like a walk down Gandhi Bazaar, the main road of Gandhi Bazaar that felt. And he's got this beautiful, his debut collection of poems called Manasu Gandhi Bazaar. That means
Oh,
my mind is Gandhi Bazaar, like a
mind
bouquet of colorful and vibrant. And I thought that even the title was so wonderful. So I was thinking I should probably engage with his poems a little more and maybe do it. And guess what? One day I was invited to Sapna Book House to record something for the 50th anniversary, because Sapna has been a part of my childhood also. So they said, will you come? And I said, sure. And I went and recorded something, and I come out, and who should I see there but somebody who was going to be recorded after me, and that was Professor Nisar.
Wow.
So my only picture with him, I translated 100 of his poems. I met him so many times, but I never took a selfie with him, or I never took a picture with him, except the very first time when I was really fangirling and I saw him in Sapna, and I said, somebody please take a picture of me and him. And that is the only picture I have in front of Sapna's bookshelves
That's
in the
amazing.
residency of Sapna store. So yeah, then thankfully I finished the 100. He was so encouraging when I told him that I want to do his poetry. He gave me all the help he could. He bought me a collection of a set of all his poetry collections, which had been newly reissued by Sapna, and he gifted them to me. And he was so crazy, he had even marked the 100 poems. He'd already decided which ones. And unfortunately, I had so many projects going on that it took me, this was sort of like a side labor of love that I was doing. I didn't have a deadline for it. I was just working on it. Although I found a publisher, the Seagull Publishers, they will be publishing the book. They were in no hurry. It was busy. So it kept taking time, and he kept on, Maad Budamma, Yavag Martya. He comes constantly after my life. And finally, when the lockdown started, there were still about 20, 30 poems to do. The lockdown started, and I had thought sabbatical. So I was fully free. I had nothing on my plate. I attended his 84th birthday celebrations at Kannada Sahitya Academy in February.
Okay.
And when I told him, I'm going to get this done now. I will finish it. And I just sat down and I finished the rest of the poems. And by April 15th or something, I called him and I told him, it's done. And then he's chuckling and saying, very well done, beta. People take much more time than this. I'm like, thank you very much. After seeing me like, continuously for 2 years, now you tell me that it's a quick job. Anyway, but this, I was gutted when just 15 days later, he passed away. But I was also very relieved to know that he, before he passed away, he knew that this project had been completed. I had done justice to it and it would be published soon sometime.
Some things are just destiny, I believe.
Yeah, no, particularly in my life, I feel I have been guided by an unseen and protective and loving hand throughout my journey. It's been sending me in this, nudging me into the directions that I have. So I'm convinced of this.
Tell us your experience with Sapna Bookhouse. I believe the Sapna Bookhouse team has translated so many of your works into Kannada, the Gita and Vedas and Upanishads, plus the Nisar Ahmad book also, which is going to come out, might be through Sapna. So how has the whole journey been?
Well, you know, it's Sapna used to, the original Sapna, which was in Gandhinagar, was very close to where I lived, where I grew up.
Okay.
We used to go there a lot. I mean, there are several iconic bookstores in Bangalore that I used to visit as a child. So there was Select off Brigade Road. Then there was Gangarams, of course, huge part of my childhood.
Okay.
There was there were a few, the Strand, what was that other, anyway, various shops, but Sapna was closest to my house. So we went there a lot. And my aunt is a librarian, like a library science teacher at the Women's Politics. So she used to buy all her books from Sapna and she used to get big discounts because she was a librarian. So, and I basically spent most of my childhood in my aunt's house. So I used to go with her every time she went to Sapna. And such a, of course, they used to do more textbooks then, but it was the only bookstore I knew that did Kannada books alongside English books.
Yeah.
And so it was a very fascinating in a different kind of way. And it was definitely a haunt of my childhood. So I remember it very fondly and continue to go there. And now I live in a different part of Bangalore where there's again, there's a Sapna very close by. So I visit a lot and the staff knows. It's really lovely. It's one of those, you know, it's one of those rare bookstores that even today you enter and ask the staff, do you have this book? They will know whether they have it. They don't have to look at a computer. They may have to look at a computer, check inventory to see if it's available now. But tell them the name and they will know and they'll go right to that shelf and they'll pick it out for you. This I used to find only in bookstores when I was young, this used to be quite common.
Hmm.
But it's not true anymore. The chain bookstore. No, people who work at the counter have no idea. But this is such a familiar, wonderful feeling when I go into Sapna. I know that I can ask the person at the counter or somebody hanging around to help in that floor. I can say like, is this there? And they will find it for immediately.
Thank you so much for such kind words. In fact, there have been so many comments of late that are coming in. There is somebody called Nia Kumar who's asking if you remember going to her school.
Nia.
Yes. And there's another, I believe, Deepika. Can't thank you enough for the Gita and Vedas and Upanishads. Can't believe someone had the courage to take this.
Yeah. Sorry, I know Nia. Come on. Sorry.
Wow.
And then what else? Thank you for the Gita and... Oh, hi, Omkar. Omkar is saying hi, auntie. One of my young readers. Okay.
To all the viewers, if you have any questions and comments for Miss Rupa Pai, please do comment right now. Miss meeting you.
Yeah, Omkar is saying I miss meeting you. But what were you saying about the other person? Sorry, I missed that.
I just read it out. Thank you. Can't thank you enough for the Gitas, Vedas and the Upanishads. Can't believe someone had the courage to take this Herculean task and simplify it for the world, not only for children. That's
thank
a very
cool
comment.
Nice. Yes, I feel blessed. I feel guided. I feel chosen. It's nothing due to me. I just channeled the wisdom and I was helped by some force to bring it in this way to children and to people.
Thank you so much for this wonderful conversation, ma'am. Looking forward to more of your work and looking forward to more Sapna Rise conversations with Sapna Bookhouse.
Thank you. Thank you, Natasha. This was a lovely conversation.
Thank you so much. Bye.
Any other questions? No, right?
We are ending. No, ma'am, actually. Just waiting for a few questions. Does anybody have any questions?
Thank you, Mohua.
Thank you for the Gita. And Ajit is asking, ma'am. Yeah, any other spiritual books in the pipeline?
Yeah, hi Ajit. Nice to see you. He came yesterday also, and then of course it didn't happen. So I'm so sorry it didn't happen yesterday, and thank you for coming back. Any other spiritual books? You know, I consider anything I write about like a spiritual experience. And if you look at any of my books, I think, but and I mean, even medicine was a spiritual experience. Mm-hmm. Writing it, I just feel so connected with people who cared so much about the welfare of the world that they went to all kinds of extents to bring their knowledge to the world. But if you mean in the genre of like the Gita and the Vedas and Upanishads, hopefully, yes, it's a landscape I love. And I'm sure I will revisit it again and again. There is no help for me. I cannot get away from it. However much I try to go away from it, I keep coming back. So yes, there will be, but I don't know yet what. This is my sabbatical year. I'm not thinking about it.
There's one more question from Omkar.
Yeah, do you think they can be... Oh, of course, Omkar, you should write it. You know, he's a very good writer, these two boys, these two twins, Omkar and Soham. Yeah, you should write it. Of course, they can be mythofiction. Indian mythology is rich and fertile in all kinds of plots and subplots. You can bring it to the 21st century. You can do what you like with it.
So many untold stories also.
Yeah, absolutely. So... Definitely. I mean, I would love to. Even my Taranauts, there is an underpinning of Indian mythology there. It's not very obvious. It's not very in your face, but children have understood it, you know. And I mean, I think one of the main things that the main core of Indian thinking that I like to put out there is that Indian philosophy, how it thinks is that there is no fully good person or a fully evil person. There isn't anything like that. We are all born with both Ram and Ravan inside of us, with both the Pandavas and Kauravas inside of us. And it's really your choices. You have the potential to be Ram, you have the potential to be Ravana, each of us. Sure. What we become is what we choose to be. So that kind of thing is, you know, I have talked about again and again in many different ways in the Taranauts books. I wish you were. Oh, so sweet.
That's a very sweet comment.
But it's enough for me that there are people like you who think so. That's enough. That makes my life worthwhile. Thank you.
We wish you all the best, ma'am. I'm sure you'll get there.
No, I don't even want to. That's not even my goal. If it happens, it happens. But that's again a blessing from the universe. I just do the work I do because I enjoy it so much and I feel compelled to do it. Because I want the beauty and wonder of Indian scriptures and Indianness in general to go out to the world. I think we have a lot to teach the world. And we just need to PR act together and put it out there.
That's true. Any other comments and questions? Gunjan Singh says hello.
Hi. Hi, Gunjan. Do you have any questions for me or you just wanted to say hi? Can you see if Gunjan is typing? We can't see that.
No, ma'am. I don't think we can see that.
All right, if we are out of time, then we can... What's the time?
I think we're almost done with 60 minutes. So Instagram has a timer.
Sure. Okay. So lovely talking to you, Natasha. Thank you
lovely
very much.
Lovely talking to you, ma'am. Thank you so much for joining us. And hopefully we'll continue our conversation for another book of yours.
Sure. Thank you so much. Bye.
Thank you. Deepika, bye,
yes.
Ma'am.
be children. That's what I do. So just because I wrote the Milind Soman book doesn't mean I have switched sides and gone over to the camp. Not at all. My big passion and my love is writing for children. So there will be more books, definitely. And generally, in general, the kind of books that Indian authors are producing for children has improved by leaps and bounds. There are many wonderful books out there. So I urge you all to go out and look at other Indian authors' books as well for children.
Yes.
Thank you. Bye bye.
Thank you so much. Bye bye. Thank you. Bye. To everyone tuned in, that was Miss Rupa Pai, and we had an amazing session with her. We at Sapna Book House bring to you Sapna Rise. So we have your favorite author coming in every week, and we give you a chance to interact with him or her. Please stay tuned. Thank you so much.